I could ask everyone to please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. All right, Mr. Shackleton, please call the roll.
Mr. Cole?
Here.
Mr. Hamilton?
Here.
Mr. Knight?
Here.
Mr. Schaefer?
Here.
Mr. Brothers?
Here.
All right, everybody present. We're up to item number four, which is adopting the agenda. I'm going to so move that we adopt the agenda.
Before you do adopt the agenda, I'd like to make an amendment here.
Okay.
Under the employment section, section B, you'll see number 26 at that number. This is my mistake. We did not catch, we sent you a list of every single person that is either working or voluntary meetings. That is not going to be approved. Only the people that are paid, that are not district employees. So Mr. Shackleton top that here, let me know that that's not how we've done it in the past. So that's my mistake. I'd like to pull that, put it back on in October with the correct list.
Okay.
And then that would still be before they would be paid at the end of the events.
Okay, that sounds good. So I'm going to amend my motion and say that I'm going to move to adopt the agenda without Exhibit B1.
I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion second. Any discussion? If not, Mr. Shackleton, please call roll.
Mr. Brothers?
Aye.
Mr. Knight?
Aye.
Mr. Hamilton?
Aye.
Mr. Cole?
Aye.
Mr. Schaefer?
Aye.
Okay, we're up to item number five, which is approval of the minutes. I'm going to make a motion that we waive the reading of the special meeting minutes from August 9th and the regular meeting minutes from August 9th, and we approve them as written.
I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Do we have any questions or discussion? If not, please call roll.
Mr. Schaefer?
Aye.
Mr. Cole?
Aye.
Mr. Brothers?
Aye.
Mr. Knight?
Aye.
Mr. Hamilton?
Aye.
Okay, we are up to item number six, which is the hearing of the public. And we have one person that is requested to speak this evening, and her name is Samantha Kramer. So Samantha, the floor is yours.
We are a family, or supposed to be a family.
go with Nate Bate, everybody. The other teachers that we have Christian Simmons, who is here. He's coming from previously working at Indian River, and so he is our part-time English teacher and English tutor to help with that gap closing. Christian, welcome. We have a couple of people who couldn't make it tonight, and that is Tanner Metz. I don't think Tanner's here. Tanner Metz is our athletic trainer, and Polly Radke is one of our new bus drivers. We're always thankful for new bus drivers. And the building that wins the prize for most new hired staff would be Walker Elementary. Let's hear it for Walker. All right, awesome. And Mrs. Bartley looked like she had a little harem around her at our new staff orientation day. So we have Carrie Hess-Labor, who is our speech-language pathologist. Carrie, we're glad to have you with us. We have Tyler Bowman, who was filling in for one of our counselors last year, and he's now hired on, so we're thrilled to have Tyler back on board with us. Welcome, Tyler. We have a new intervention specialist, and that's Dulcie Myers. Dulcie, glad to have you. And we have a paraprofessional. We have Tamara Hudson is not with us this evening either. She's one of our new paraprofessionals. And our other new para at Walker is Alexis Dalton. And the paras and the bus drivers are the ones that make the daily operations of our district actually work. So we couldn't do it without them. And finally, we have our title tutor staff. We practically have an entirely new title tutor team, and they are a group of fantastic, fantastic people. So we have Amanda Piles. She was a sub for us last year in the building. Amanda, we're so glad to have you on board as a title tutor. We have Nellie Way, who's with us as one of our new title tutors, and Carissa Deeds. And Cindy Clewer. I think Cindy Clewer wins for the longest journey to Canton South. She's coming from Las Vegas. So her luck ran out. So I have the pleasure of working with this group of staff at our new staff orientation in August. And I'll tell you right away, I mean, it was a great group. The energy, the vitality, the enthusiasm, professionalism, great questions. It was just a pleasure working with them, and I look forward to all the great things they're going to contribute to Canton Local and our students this year. Thank you. And I'll let them know officially so they won't feel awkward that you may go ahead and leave and enjoy your evening, or you may stay for the board meeting. It's your choice.
Well, thank you for coming, and welcome to our Canton Local family. It's great to have you. Okay, we are up to item number 9, which is treasurer report. Mr. Shanton.
Okay, quite a few things tonight on my agenda. First thing, as always, is the monthly financial reports. This is for the month ended August 31st, 2021. Page 1 is the cash reconciliation. The total deposit accounts, the end of August total of debt service fund to pay off the bonds, $1,934,777. Total of our capital projects funds, that includes our current improvement fund, and then our state share of the project fee to go over $490,21, and our capital projects fund, our local share that we moved our money into to pay for the local share, $507. The total of those three funds, $16,119,833.87. Our scholarship funds, $44,490.
for discussion? Jess, please call the roll.
Mr. Hamilton?
Aye.
Mr. Schaefer?
Aye.
Mr. Cole?
Aye.
Mr. Brothers?
Aye.
Mr. Bennett?
Aye.
All right, thank you, Mr. Schaefer. We are up to item number 10, which is communications.
Yeah, absolutely. So before we get started here, the students of the month, just so you're aware, we have our first students of the month here in September. They will be honored then at the October school board meeting, so just so you're aware of that. As far as we go through some other things here, athletic council, I have Mr. Moore, our high school principal, who I'm going to have come forward and just kind of give you an update of where we stand with our fall sports right now. So I'm going to turn over to Mr. Moore.
Thank you. I just want to give an update to everybody about fall sports and where we are. This is from Mr. Dennison today, trying to be as updated and current as we can.
Okay.
Football is currently 3-2 and headed to Marlington this week to take on the Dukes. The Wildcat offense is on pace to break several school records. We've seen that all season, great offensively. Volleyball, current record is 5-6. They're showing great improvement. They have a 90.4 serving average with 92 aces, and if you know about volleyball, 90.4 is outstanding. Boys soccer, current record.
Hey, Mr. Moore.
Yep.
If you can talk loud, you can turn that off, buddy.
Okay.
I was going to say, that may help. And then Mr. Stepanovich, you can do your thing, that'd be even better.
Yeah. That's not me. All right. Okay, we'll go without that. I don't need it.
Thank you.
Boys soccer current record is 1-3-2. They've given up 10 fewer goals than last season at this point of the campaign. Improvement is coming. It's shown this year. Girls soccer record 5-2-1. They're playing Coventry tonight. If you get out there before the game's over, please stop. They're on track to have their fourth winning season in a row, and they are at a plus 11 goal differential. Girls tennis, the girls have a 6-8 record. They have an undefeated week this past week while battling some injuries, so it's great for them to be able to battle through that as a team. Boys golf, the team is 2-13 on the season. However, Don Mackey and Andrew Bilalaki have just both registered team lows with a 40 for a 9 holes, so both doing outstanding shooting at golf. Girls golf has a school record, 9 wins this season. Delaney Kruger set the all-time individual scoring mark with a 38 in a 9-hole match at Fairless. Cross country, the boys team won the Claymont Invitational and were runner-up at Newcomerstown. This is the first invitational win for the boys since the 1990s. Brady Noel currently has the 8th fastest time in the district. The girls team finished 6th in the Newcomerstown Invitational. Alexis Justice has the 9th fastest time in the district. And also just want to mention, I know it's not athletics, I apologize, but our band shows have started also. They were at Stowe, they have Dover coming up this week, and our drama kids are practicing for Mamma Mia. So that's all the co-curricular, extracurricular activities that are very active right now. Very proud of all our students who are involved in both co- and extracurriculars. A lot of time that goes into those, so we're very proud to have so many people involved with that. So, thank you, Mr. Moore.
Thank you. Okay, as far as student representatives of the board, and I know Mr. Moore and I talked, the plan is to hopefully have them here ready to go for the October. I'll be honest, there was so much contact tracing during the month of September that I mean this in all sincerity, I don't know that Mr. Moore had time to do anything else at some point in time, and it's a little bit overwhelming, so it's something we want to make sure. I know there's a process, and some of you are involved with it, and he'll get you there to get you involved to get them ready to go. So just making sure you're in the loop. As far as facilities, I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Noel just to give us a little update here.
Appreciate it, Mr. Gangley, and just like Mr. Moore was just talking about, a lot of exciting things going on in Fibson here in Canton, a good vision, and we're very proud of that. I'll start down at the new middle school. Right now, the big focus is to seal that building in before cold weather starts to hit. So you've seen roof, you've seen sheeting going up, all of that work is happening, the windows are starting to go in. That project is progressing nicely. Still, in the overall scheme of things, a little bit behind schedule. furniture package did come in, so the last thing that we have kind of that's still out there, as far as upcoming bills with that project, would be the demolition of Walker. I've had meetings the past couple of weeks with people to walk through, take a look at it, start looking at the different options, costs, abatement, all of that good stuff to be able to get that project in hand when we get to that point. We have had, today after school, I met up with the architects at Faircrest, which is going to be the elementary. We focused on a lot of the things early in the meeting about that we're already doing there, new bathrooms, new HVC, HVAC, all throughout, all of that stuff. But today's focus was to look at phase two, which includes the preschool areas, making sure that those rooms are set up for our preschool kids to be able to come right in. If you've ever been into that building, room 100 is a tiered room, very, very big room right in the middle of the building. Being a huge tiered room does not work for little peanuts, so we're going to do what we can, split that into two rooms and be able to use that for a variety of purposes. So all of those things are happening, along with looking at new lighting, new ceiling tile, new ceiling grid, all of those different things. When we open up Faircrest to be an elementary, we want those kids to feel just as good about walking into that building as our new middle schoolers will walking into that one. So we've got a lot of work ahead of us. We've already got a lot done, but we're going to keep going because the last thing we want is people to say, well, your other two buildings are great, what about this one? And I think when they walk into Faircrest, they're going to feel very, very good about it. Only other thing that and has come up a couple times, we talked about it, we do have drawings, and I'm more than happy to share out with anybody. Outdoor playground, play area for our kids up at Faircrest, we have that in. It's something that we are very, very excited about, not only for our kids, but for our community. So that's also in the works. So we've got a lot going, but it's all good stuff. Board, any questions about any of those things? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. So I'm going to skip over curriculum program because a lot of that was when Trisha came up to introduce her new staff to you. I'm going to stand up and talk just because I feel more comfortable doing that, so hopefully that doesn't offend you. But before I do, and I go through my part of it here, and Mr. Green, can you hear me in the back? Before I do, I just want to say thank you to this group of administrators, to the teachers, to our staff. It has been a really good start to the year. It's been crazy. It is not what anybody envisioned when we stood up there on Convocation Day a year ago. It's not. I didn't envision this. I didn't envision all the quarantine. But what it's been is a really good team effort. I have been so proud walking the building, seeing our kids in classroom, seeing our kids out in extracurricular, seeing our kids all over the place. And that only happens because of the work of the people you see here, all the people they represent. Within their, I see our union leadership on both sides, with all the people that are there, and to our families. It has been fantastic. We are very, very blessed to be here in Canton. We really are. We have ways to improve. We've got to improve, and we're going to, but it's a great place to be, and I'm proud to be here. And so just want to publicly say thank you to all of you for that. My report to you is just going to give you the update on where we are with COVID right now and where we are with the mask. As everybody in this room knows, we started this year trying to be mask recommended, but not mandatory. We quickly learned that that was not working for us as cases came in. As of Tuesday, August 31st, we had 26 positive cases, 196 students and staff members have been quarantined out of our district. With those numbers, please know those do include the sick student or the sick staff member, and if they have a brother or sister that's in their house. So just so you're aware of that as well. We made the announcement on, I believe it was September 1st, that we were going to put it into effect right away for our staff on September 2nd, but it wouldn't go into effect until September 7th, which was the Tuesday after Labor Day, for everybody else. At that time, we could finally stop doing in-school quarantine for people that wore masks appropriately, starting on September 9th. You may say, why not September 7th? Because the quarantine guidelines we need to follow, they go 48 hours from when you first started showing symptoms. So just for example, if Mr. Schaefer showed symptoms today, and I was sitting with him without a mask, I would have to go back 48 hours from today who he was around. So just making sure you're aware. So By that time, we had now up to 44 cases, and we had to bump out 339 students or staff members. Just so you get the idea of where we are with this. Since we have fully had our quarantine, or excuse me, fully had our mask policy in place, we have had 23 more positive cases of students or staff members. We have had to quarantine 43 students or staff members out of the building. And these numbers are accurate from when I printed this off at the very end of the school day today. I see you shaking your head that they might not be accurate anymore, but I promise you they were accurate when I hit print. With that being said, we've been able to not quarantine 168 more kids. So I want you to picture, I don't know the numbers on how many of those would have been vaccinated, how many of those would have been because of masks. We only, the families share that with us, but 168 more would have been out right now since September 9th if we didn't have these on. So the reason we have these, and the reason why we're looking at this right now, is I want all these great things to continue. I want all those events that Mr. Moore talked about. I want our kids in school with our teachers. I want our kids having the most normal school year. I want to dance here on October 1st or 2nd in this area that we open up there that can go outside too, so our kids get the best experience possible. So I just thank you for your support. I know in talking to all of you, you've all been very supportive. We are going to constantly monitor this data. We are going to constantly look at it, and we will make recommendations to continue on and pull the masks off, obviously. Listen, just being very honest right now, we're going to look back at September 30th, but if the trend numbers continue where they are, I want to be honest, I don't see any way they're coming off on September 30th. And again, we will look at that. I have conversations, but we're looking at data. But I want everyone to know, and especially this board, and I appreciate all of your guidance and your support through all of this, just what numbers we're looking at all the time, and I want our public to be aware of that. In total, we have had to quarantine 383 students or staff members from school, 43 since fully masking up. We have been able to save, though, 284 more through masking or vaccination, and 168 of them. One other thing, COVID dashboard, and I just don't want anybody to be confused in our community. Some of you may look, and our board, I think I've kept you up to date on this, but I want to be public with this as well. You may look on there and see, well, wait a second, Brett, you just said there's 67 total cases. That dashboard says 6. And the reason for that is that dashboard is only counting active cases. So once a student or staff member is cleared to come back, they are pulled off of there. That is how many active cases we have going at any one time. Just so you're aware. On the very back of this sheet, you'll see data. And the reason I shared this with you is we've been asked a lot this year why we're not doing online learning, why we're not doing remote learning, why we're not doing some type of online program. We understand that this was not an easy decision for a lot of families. We understand that the masks were very controversial at times. However, and even we understand families earlier in the year were concerned with why we weren't offering it with the safety. Our goal, and it's why we have the masks on, to keep our kids in school. And I want to show you this data in case you're asked or in case people know. If you look, this is a chart that shows the passing rate on every Ohio State test last year for a kid, and it's broken down by if they spent any time whatsoever on remote learning last year, like out and back and forth, or if they were in person. And I will not review all of them with you, but I'll give you some examples. Third grade reading, if you spent any part of the year on remote instruction last year, those kids passed at a 36%. If you were in person all year, they passed at a 63%. High school geometry, and I'll be honest with you, as a former high school principal, this is my least favorite test they give. If you did any remote learning at all, 7% of our students passed. If you were sitting in the classroom, 45.8% passed. I'm not celebrating that number with you, but that's pretty close to what the state average is. And so I just want you to know, if you get asked me why we're not doing online, we want our kids with us. We want our kids in person, we want them with our teachers, and this is our best way to do it. So I just wanted to make sure you guys as a board had all the information, you could see it, know how we're making decisions as they come to you, and just appreciate all of you, all five of you, your support as we have gone through this and what you've done with us, okay? Any questions on this for me out of you guys?
move up to item 11, which is the superintendent's report.
Okay, we're going to start first with some resignations. And I'm just going to go down through them. We had Lisa Richmond, an educational parapro from Walker. Kate Clark, an educational paraprofessional from Kent South High School. Greg Fudge, who is our head boys tennis coach. He's resigning his supplemental contract. Barb Elsass, she is actually going to resign as our choreographer, spring musical supplemental contract. Jim Rondinella is our chess coach. And Brandon Leach, who was an educational paraprofessional at Kent South High School, and we'll be accepting his resignation effective at the after September 27th. He gave us a 2 weeks notice, received a full-time job, just a much better opportunity for him. So it's my recommendation that the board accept the resignation of all those people, and we thank them very much for their time here in the district. For employment, we have quite a few. Lucy Thompson, we would like to recommend her for the choreography spring musical supplemental contract effective for this school year. Nicole Boyd for the ninth grade class advisor supplemental. The next two I'd like to talk about just a second, Chris Berger and Craig Reeser. You see that fall site manager, 50% stipend supplemental contract for each of them. When we hired Coach Dennison as our athletic director, we talked about having a fall site manager, and really a site manager that can go throughout. Mr. Dennison interviewed people, decided on recommending both of them. They've been doing a great job for us, covering events, being there, helping and doing everything you need to. But if you wonder why 50-50, there's a lot of events. It was a little bit better. And then on Friday night football games, some of our bigger events, both of them are in there working, and they're working that out. Okay, the next one is Scott Stair. Now, Scott was approved back in June as our cross-country coach. As I came in, one of the things I learned was that Scott was promised that he would be given 1.5 stipend instead of one because of being both the boys and the girls coach. This has been past practice in other sports. It has not been specifically spelled out that way, and I'm going to work with the union. We've already had some conversations about that to make sure that we go through and really clean up language in there with some of those supplementals. But Mr. Stair was promised this, and that I would like to recommend that we honor what was promised to him when he was offered the job, and kind of go from there to make sure that we are doing what we said we would do. Number six is Cody Edwards, head baseball coach. Cody was our co-head coach last year. Do you guys remember Cody and Trent were approved as co-head coaches last year? Cody did interview and meet with Mr. Dennison, but he would be recommended as our head baseball coach. For head softball coach, Cassandra Stanford, I'm so sorry. That position was posted and put out throughout the summer. It was posted on the Star County website as well as on our website throughout. There were three applicants for that. Coach Dennison talked to two of them and is recommending, through me, I make recommending Cassandra Stanford. Then we go down for educational parapros, Diane Hoffner, an educational parapro at Canton South, Lindsay Kluman, a cafeteria worker at Canton South, Rebecca Dusky, and I hope I'm saying that right, cafeteria worker at Canton South, Alexis Dalton, she is becoming an educational parapro for our, you might have even met her earlier, she was a temporary, it's becoming a permanent now. Peggy Ritiger, educational parapro for our temporary position. If you flip over number 13, Georgia Marconi, educational paraprofessional. This is a 7-hour temporary position at Faircrest Memorial Middle School. Paige Parsons, an educational paraprof, 4-hour Canton South High School. The next one, number 15, Catherine Wirtz Cardina. She is replacing Ann Blue. If you remember, we received Ann Blue's retirement. Very excited to get Catherine. She has been doing the exact same job at Jackson Schools, and we're able to steal her from Jackson over here to Camp Logo and excited to have her. We think that's going to lead to a very, very smooth transition because she has been working on the same system, same everything, doing the exact same job. Another one, number 16, Notori Smith. I believe I had spoken to each of you about this. When we moved Coach Dennison out of the CBI position into the athletic director position, it opened up the CBI position. We posted that job. We did not receive anyone that was a CDI qualified instructor. So at that point in time, we started filling the year with Victoria Smith, who was our long-term sub. but he is going to fill that position for the year. We're going to repost it. But the reason why you see that going to the BA level zero is because after so many days, 60 days, they automatically go to that level. Notori has been doing this since the beginning of school, doing a very good job. We just feel it's fair and appropriate when we know that he's going to be filling that import to treat him fairly and to pay him at that level. Number 17 ties in with number 16. Kyle Decker is who we'd like to recommend to be placed as the permanent sub now for Notori Smith, who we're moving over to that other position here, Kent South. That will be paid out of those ESSER funds like we talked about in that beginning meeting. Same with Ashley Courtney. If you remember, we had a permanent sub who actually at Walker who resigned to take a more permanent position at Brown Schools. Ashley Courtney will be replacing her at Walker as a permanent sub. Andrina Solvi will be the district permanent sub, just like we talked about in that earlier meeting, where she will be housed at Walker, but available to go anywhere else. Just from a former high school principal's perspective, it is much easier to cover classes at a high school and a middle school than it is at the elementary because of the nature of how things go. So we're housing her over there if needed. All of those will be paid, 17, 18, 19, will be paid out of those ESSER funds. Number 20, Brooke Boyer, substitute educational parapro for the year. Holly Richards, substitute educational parapro. Joseph Blevins, substitute cafeteria worker. Carrie Sawyer, substitute cafeteria worker. Lance Jones, substitute custodian and maintenance. And then number 25, Riley Froelich. Riley is part of our CBI, career-based intervention program here, working with Notori. He is our first student that we've been able to get out, placed, and hired. He has been working with our groundskeeper, Mr. Bob Wessel, and he has been doing a fantastic job helping keep up on projects outside, teaching him work ethic, teaching him skills, providing him with a job. We'd like to recommend that we hire him on as a CBI worker for us here, and we may have more of these throughout the year as we provide job opportunities for some of our students to help them as they transition into that career field someday. So those, and then finally, if you remember, I pulled number 26, or asked for you guys to pull number 26. I'll have an updated one, and I apologize for my catching that mistake. But it is my recommendation to the board that we approve the personnel listed above. Gifts and donations. The board, here we have the Blackburn Giving Fund donated $120 to Walker. Nikki Boyd, who's our high school guidance counselor, donated $200 to a Boyd Scholarship Fund. Waco Epworth Methodist Church, $200 to Walker Elementary. MC Brady Soft Tissue and Sports Chiropractic donated $20 to athletics. Dave Andrews and family, this extremely kind of him, donated $250 through all season sports passes to our student athletes, gave to the athletic department to use to help make sure our kids could get into games as well. Our kindergarten shirt donation, we put that out for people to sponsor those shirts. The Andrews family came in at $100, with Walker PTO, $250, Bill and Pam Wright, $250, S&M Electrical, $250, Sabatino MMA and Fitness, $250, Donald and Betty Knoll, proud to be a Wildcat, $100, Mary Ann Donuts, $100, the Scott and Edie Hamilton Foundation Fund, $250, M&M Lawn and Lean Cleanup, $100, PPS Merchandise, $100, and Patriot Property Service, $100. Those shirts have been delivered to all of our kindergartners, and any excess money that we have left over from that is being put into water to make sure we're using it on Kindergarten Fest, to make sure we're having the beds and things to welcome our incoming kindergartners as we move forward in the next year as well. Kent South Athletic Booster Club donations, golf course membership to Spring Valley, $1,600, girls soccer bowls, $1,485, boys basketball camp, $1,000, girls basketball camp, $614.50, boys soccer bowls, $1,485, general athletic iPads and tripod cases, $6,238, and it is my recommendation that we absolutely accept these gifts and donations from these people who donated to us. So the next one, item D, urgent necessity to waive competitive billing for playground equipment at Fairfax. We've talked about this playground several times today, but I want to make sure you understand why we're asking you to do this. There's a couple reasons here. First of all, it's time sensitivity. As we have learned through this billing process, and I think everybody's learning, supplies and things are not in inventory levels where they've been in the past. We are afraid that if we go through a full billing out process, that we will possibly run of playground equipment, particularly the playground equipment we are going to be purchasing, we need to make sure that they're going to be there 20 years down the road, 10 years down the road, 15 years down the road, where possibly the lowest bidder is not. And we need to make sure this equipment can be updated, can be repaired, can be replaced as needed. And so just so you know, Mr. Schatz and Mr. Knoll have done a ton of work on this. They have been on the phone with our legal representation and we've done all of our building. They say all of this is 100% above board and within what we can do to waive that competitive bid. Just so you're aware of that. Next one, item E, payment in lieu of transportation. By law, we either have to transport or provide payment to any family that is choosing to go to a different school due to a disability or a scholarship or something, or we place them there. Well, we have a student that is attending Kids First School for Autism in Akron. The family is, instead of us paying them, has requested payment. So instead of us putting a van or hiring a bus driver to drive them up, we would like to pay them $40 a day, which is at the federal mileage rate for every day that that student is in attendance. And then they'll be submitting that back there. That goes through our Office of Special Services. Mrs. Hessing does a wonderful job keeping track of the value of the bill. But I'd like to recommend that we accept that and make that payment in lieu of transportation. Item F, Sunday use of school athletic, or school, excuse me, school facility. We've had a request from the North Industry United Methodist Church to use our back parking lot as a trunk or treat from 11:30 to 2:15. This will not have anything to do with our school, but rather will just be an opportunity for them to use our facility, for kids to come through here, have a safe place to trick or treat. I said I wouldn't mention this in public, but I will be watching the Browns beat the Steelers at that time, so I will not be over here. It's not a school event. We just want to make sure if anybody's using our facilities on Sunday, that we get that approved. And then the next one, Mrs. Fatzinger and the Canton South High School Music, or our Canton South High School Musical Director, has submitted a request to hold a performance of our musical on Sunday, November 7th at 2 o'clock. The reason for that is we have multiple students that are involved in athletics, and we have students that are involved in, we could possibly have a playoff football game on that Friday night. So instead of having it on a Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, what she would like to do is have it on Saturday, a 2 o'clock performance, then an evening performance, and then a Sunday afternoon performance at 2 o'clock. To make sure our students have worked so hard, get out and do all three performances, but we're not at the last minute trying to reschedule if there's any conflicts or anything like that with everything. So again, I'd like to recommend the board approve the Sunday facilities, and that is the end of my report.
Okay, I'm going to so move on items A through F.
I'll second.
Okay, we've got a motion and a second. Do we have any questions or discussion? Please call the roll.
Mr. Cole?
Aye.
Mr. Hamilton?
Aye.
Mr. Knight?
Aye.
Mr. Schaefer?
Aye.
Mr. Brothers?
Aye. Okay, thank you, Mr. Jago. And we are up to informational items. Anything on the legislative side of the board concerns?
Nothing this one.
Okay. All right, we're up to item 12, which is questions pertaining to our agenda items and board actions. Anybody have any questions pertaining to our agenda items and board actions?
And just to answer right there, in the high 400,000, just like you said, including that grant money being taken off.
Yeah, it's 481. The amount of the resolution is $481,042.48.
Thanks.
Okay, does anybody else have any questions? Okay, if not, then we're going to move on to item 13, which is other business. All right, I have one item. We've had a request to change the date of our October board meeting from October 18th to October 11th. And we also like to move it from multi-county to this location right here. So I guess I ask my fellow board members, does anybody have a problem with that? Good?
Yeah.
Okay, we'll go ahead and make the change.
Can I do one more item for other business?
Go ahead.
The Business Advisory Council, one of the services that's provided to us by the Stark County BSC is that they meet with businesses from all over Stark County, and they have a Business Advisory Council that they pass off each of their member districts. We have that included in here. I just want to make sure you know, as we move forward, and as we get into that January, it's time for us to review our strategic plan. And part of that strategic plan is getting input from stakeholders all the way around. And one of the most crucial pieces to that in what we want to do in getting our kids to be career ready are our business partners. So as we move into January, while we will continue to use this service through the Stark County ESC, and that's always good and helpful, in fact, tomorrow morning, Mr. Schatz and I have a meeting with all the treasurers and the superintendents of the ESC. That's something we're going to work to do to get input from our business community for how we can better prepare our kids to be career ready and how we can partner with them. And we're going to start that process in January just to make sure you're all aware of that. Thanks, Mr. Noem. We were aware of looking at that. We know that's not been past practice, but in trying to keep to a Monday night that was second there, I didn't think we would have any issues with it being on Columbus not being in school here with anything like that. Thank you. Because our staff will still report that day for in service with everything. Yep, no, appreciate it. Thank you for looking out. Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, any other businesses? All right, if not, item 14, executive session. Not aware that we need an executive session tonight. Is that correct? Okay. All right, so we're up to item 15. I'm going to so move